ancient Oriental proverb says, a thousand years a ghost, ah, better one day a man. How many men in all parts of the world ultimately find themselves asking, am I really a man? Am I really living? Or am I simply a ghost, an empty shell? This is the problem of purpose. And it was in reflection on this problem that Yoshio Yamamoto spent many hours by the small pool in his home. In post-war Japan, purpose was a luxury enjoyed by very few. An ancient saying states, silly boys in time become silly old men. And in his youth, Yoshio had certainly been a silly boy.
My father was far too indulgent with me. I attended school when I pleased, or the theater, or movies if I pleased. I might have become an actor myself. Many thought I showed skill. But such a career could never be explored. We were suddenly at war, and the emperor called us to the high purpose of establishing our empire throughout the Orient and the world. I shall never forget that summer in 1944, as we fought to maintain our possession of Saipan. I was hit in the leg, shattered, broken. I could not tell. Many of my countrymen were dying all around me. I could not retreat with the others. Suddenly, two of the enemy were upon me. One shouted, no worry, no worry. But I knew what to expect. I knew I would soon be executed. Just as I did not understand the shouting of, no worry, so I did not understand the care I was given. And then many of us were placed on a ship, which ultimately deposited us in a prisoner of war camp in the United States of America. Soon, I thought, soon would come the execution. This was some strange form of torture, the building of hopes, and then death. I had never seen nor tasted this kind of food. The American word for it was bacon. It was tasty, but I thought it must be very poor food since it was given to us prisoners. The execution I expected never came. I grew stronger. I learned much of the American tongue. I was even given useful work to do. Hardly the treatment one who has surrendered in battle deserves. But it was at the daily workout that I was first offered a genuine friendship. My leg was not able to function in its weakened state. A lieutenant showed concern for my condition. As we talked, he seemed to more than just tolerate me as a prisoner. And he told me of his religious beliefs. As time went on, he told me of his Lord, his Savior, he called him, Jesus Christ. But then, the war was over, and I was on my way home. The words of faith from the American lieutenant faded into a kind of dream from the past. I had been told of my country's surrender, but I did not believe it. Of course the Americans would say that. Of course. But one heart-sickening look at the area surrounding the Emperor's palace told me that all they said was true. What of the Emperor's fine words? Had he not told us we could never lose? We had the stronger spirits, he said, and that made more of a power difference than better arms. All the gods were allied with us, he said. And was he not a god himself? Were his great words of no more value than the thousands of lies it is our custom to live by? A lie is told to make life easier. But if the Emperor's words were a lie, why? Why this? Are men placed on this earth to kill and destroy? How can I know? Why was I spared to see this? Nothing. And then I was home, or what was once home. Can a man keep from bitter thoughts when he realizes that where he was enjoying the enemy's hospitality, the enemy was destroying his home, killing his family? Perhaps these workmen know more than this rubble can tell me. No, it is like this everywhere. What does one do? Where does one go? Then suddenly, there was again hope. Another workman had heard that before the bombings, many had evacuated to the country, to Gobo, in Wakayama Prefecture. Perhaps in Gobo. Perhaps. A few days later, on my arrival in Gobo, I was told that a family with my name was living nearby. My family had no knowledge of me. They did not know whether I was living or dead, and very few of my countrymen came back. It was with pounding hearts that my mother and I embraced after so long a time. Then my father and brother, I am certain that no soldier returning from any battle could have had a warmer welcome. My country now began to rebuild. The rubble of the war had to be buried. Lives, as well as our cities, had been torn to bits. Once centered around the ancient gods, our existence seemed to lose its flooring as the emperor admitted publicly that he was just a man. But the West showed us the way. Where a prisoner, I had seen the riches of America. Tall buildings, powerful industry. This was the way. The gods were forced by their own admission. Away with them. It was time to build Japan in the image of the conquerors. In our universities, we began to integrate the philosophies of the East and West, weaving patterns of thought as diversified as the clothing of the students. But it was not long before the old gods began to stir. Shinto had all but died when it was officially divorced from state support. But Buddhism was more deeply rooted. For some, it was heritage and tradition to be viewed through the sophisticated lens of a new camera. But for many, as the shock of the war began to ease, it was the authority of the past. Our great history, our great culture, was based on the ancient teachings and rituals. They could not remain dead. The new temples and shrines, like the new Japan, were a combination of modern and ancient beauty. Escalators carried worshippers from floor to floor as they paid homage to the ancient gods. Was the new god of progress, of materialism, brought to us from the West, that brought with it new forms of worship. But we also had the age-old goddess of licentiousness and the god of covetousness. Perhaps this worship was not as formal, not as beautiful as was the worship of the ancient gods, but it was every bit as intense and involving. It was not long before we discovered that near the end of each year, our Buddhist and Shinto heritage could be placed in the background as we corrected profit from the material Christ in the celebration of his birth. But somehow, this was not the Christ I remember hearing about as a prisoner. Well, no matter. The economy is greatly helped by this worship. It was during this season and along these aisles that my beloved Kikuyo came, looking for her wedding attire. Although she chose to wear the traditional headdress which signifies strict obedience to me, her husband, I was wise enough to know that women are not the servile subjects they once were in Japan. Suddenly so full, it was difficult to support the two of us from the meager earning of my soap route. I sold soap from house to house, in and through the mountains around Gobo. From sunup, sometimes until after midnight, my bicycle and boxes of soap were my only companions. My poor young bride had much inconvenience to which to adjust, but the business was growing. And soon, so was her family. The arrival of a child can stir many a sleeping thought and feeling. Neither Kikuyo nor I are especially religious, but there are 2,500 years of authority behind the gods. It could do no harm to dedicate our little girl to the very best of life. Perhaps, as the gods took notice of her, they also took notice of us. Perhaps they took notice, I do not know. The soap business grows. My brother and I have opened an office and storage space in town. Now I have two daughters. Life is comfortable, present. Then why this vague emptiness? Why am I plagued by dissatisfaction?
And so it was that Yoshio spent many hours by the small pool in front of his home, puzzling his existence, his purpose. There must be more to life than simply being successful, comfortable, having many children. Perhaps the recent death of Yoshio's father stirred these questions in his mind. He now held the position of authority in the family, and as head, found himself forced to interpret tradition to his growing family. Kikuyo was a modern Japanese wife, and although she followed the custom of serving everyone, of subjecting her own will to that of Yoshio first, and then his mother, she did not understand nor like the role. Perhaps, Yoshio thought, perhaps even our traditions are obscure bits of meaninglessness. And still there was the never-ending selling of soap. Alone on his bicycle, Yoshio continued searching. So much of his existence, which was backed by centuries of tradition and authority, seemed empty. Why? Why should this meaninglessness bother him? Others, his friends, his neighbors, his own family, seemed content with the ways of their lives. Why should he be so agitated? There are times when a coincidence is hard to explain in any other way than providence. The words of the sound truck cut through Yoshio's consciousness and left him with the feeling that somehow... He had not thought seriously of Christianity since his days as a prisoner in the United States. Oh, an occasional random thought had crossed his mind, but today even his brother noticed his preoccupation. The Christian lieutenant during the war had told him much of Christianity. Yet now that he thought about it, it wasn't so much about the faith or philosophy of Christianity as it was about the man, Jesus Christ. Somehow he presented the answer to life. There was something about sin. He hadn't understood it very well. It seemed simply a description of the way he lived. But that was a long time ago, and the soap route needed attention. There is a story of an architect who was so offended by the looks of a house he passed daily that he bought it, moved in, and never noticed it again. Just so, every day, Yoshio moved through mountains and past lakes near his home, so beautiful that a tourist would run out of film snapping them. But to Yoshio, this was only a difficult soap route. Today, his mind was on the past, his days as a prisoner, the lieutenant who had told him of Jesus Christ, the truck announcing tent meetings near his home. And as he thought, his pace increased. He would attend a meeting. He would see for himself what Christianity had to say about purpose. When evening came, Yoshio was ready. He did not wish to appear too anxious, however, so adopting the casual attitude of a man out for a stroll, he happened by the tent. There was something familiar about the smile and look of the men at the entrance. The singing, too, Yoshio found attractive. And looking in, he almost thought the speaker to be his American friend from the past. Trying not to call attention to himself, Yoshio quietly found a seat and listened. The words hardly seemed to him the good news promised by the truck. Yoshio was told that every man alive was a sinner, that in living for themselves, all men had rejected God, and that even the most respectable man was lost, that man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Yoshio's interest aroused, he returned the next night, and the next. And in clear, simple words, he was told what God has done for man. Jesus Christ was born, miraculously, the very Son of God and Son of Man. Jesus Christ lived the life that the justice of God demands of all men. And then Jesus Christ died, suffering the punishment that the justice of God demands of all men.
If Jesus Christ died for every man, That means he died for me.
And finally, Yoshio could hold back no longer. He accepted the sacrifice of the Son of God for himself. After the meeting, Yoshio and the missionary looked into God's word. It was all there. The purpose, to love, enjoy, and serve God. The problem, man's own choice to live for himself. The solution, the higher choice to live for God. And upon acceptance of the forgiveness of God through Christ, the very Spirit of God comes into the believer, bringing all the guidance, help, strength, everything necessary to transform the believer's character. Perhaps his introduction to Christianity years ago had affected his thinking more than he suspected. All Yoshio knew was that here was the solid answer to all his flimsy discontentment. Almost immediately, Yoshio saw the need to tell others of his wonderful discovery. Kikuyo was a gentle woman, content with her life as his wife. She was pleased at his new happiness, but felt little need for herself. The office, his brother was openly antagonized by Yoshio's commitment, especially when Yoshio insisted that there was none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And with his mother, his frustration and discouragement were heavy. She was a Tenrikyo believer. This sect of Shintoism was begun by a university professor who was so impressed with what he found in the Bible that he reworded it slightly and presented it as Tenrikyo teachings. Yoshio's mother recognized many of the things he told her of Christianity, but she could not discern the vast difference between the Tenrikyo religion and true life in Christ, and felt no reason to change. And so for a while, it was only Yoshio and one of his small daughters who were seen each Sunday at the services of the Gobo Christian Church. It was clear that, in order to meet the spiritual needs of his family, Yoshio had to know more of the faith he now embraced. There is a saying, food cures hunger, study cures ignorance. And Yoshio was intent on learning. His rapt attention drew forth richer and richer teachings from the missionaries. And at home, his education continued under the greatest teacher in the universe. And no one could have predicted the extreme trial of his new faith he would soon face. Yoshio's new life was beginning to have an effect on those around him. His eager attendance of services, his obvious love and profit from the Bible he spent so much time reading, his life, more than simply a respectable shell, a truly humble, truly good existence. These elements finally broke through the calm of his dear Kikuyo. As she opened her life to Jesus Christ, a paradox of excitement and eternal serenity filled the emptiness she never knew existed. His daughters were next, asking Jesus into their hearts in Sunday school. Yoshio's family began to grow and worship together. If only Mother, what will it take to reach her? Then one morning, before a small group of believers and curious friends, Yoshio stepped into the cold sea. How surprisingly warm it felt. Not at all distracting as he publicly identified himself with Jesus Christ in baptism. Yoshio's quick grasp of his faith and responsibility surprised even the missionaries. The purpose for which he had searched so long now ruled his life. He helped with his time, his mind, his strength. Who knew better than Yoshio the value of tent meetings? He helped set up. He led singing. He told of his own meeting with Jesus inside a tent. As a respected businessman, even his soap route became more than simply a means of income. His views on the cleansing of souls was given more thoughtful attention. What a thrill for Yoshio when the missionaries first asked him to accompany them to a little fishing village on a nearby island. He was going to be the main speaker at the meeting. It was a small group of devout believers who warmly greeted them. They were anxious for their village neighbors to hear the message of redemption from the lips of others as well as their own. In the village, he was listened to with interest. He assured his hearers, Jesus Christ is God's gift, not only to one class, or one country, or one side of the world. He is God's gift to every man who receives him. The ride back was a happy exchange. Yoshio's words seemed to have found understanding ears among the hardened fishermen. And then the blessing of God seemed to open beyond all expectation. Kikuyo delivered a son. After only daughters, now a son. This time, no long walk to the temple. The boy was named Kenji, which means offered to God. And soon after his birth, the dedication was made official. 5 rice bowls now. 1 for a son.
Oh God, you have been so generous to your servant. May this son of mine bring glory and souls to you. May he be allowed to accomplish far more than you have permitted me. Lord, accept my little Kenji for your service.
Children are always a delight. But a man's first son. Come, my little man, in order to live in Japan, you must learn to use chopsticks. No son was ever more doted upon than was Kenji. Yoshio, from the beginning, spent many hours playing with, training, loving his little boy. It was because he knew his son so well that Yoshio realized this crying was not a normal complaint. Day after day, as Yoshio and Kikuyo watched, little Kenji grew weaker and weaker. An ancient Oriental proverb laments, "Sorrow is the child of too much joy." And so it seemed that night as little Kenji struggled for breath. Calls were made for help, but no doctor was available. Now it was the gods who were called upon for help. Grandmother prayed with every bit of strength and earnestness she possessed for the life of Kenji. And Yoshio prayed,
Oh God, my little boy, my little Kenji, please help us. Help me to accept your will, no matter what.
Every effort of living concern was bestowed upon little Kenji as the lights burned through the night. But that night, the little boy, whose name meant offered to God, went to live with his God forever. The cemetery seemed too crowded, even for its tiny new visitor. Most of Yoshio's relatives had never seen a Christian funeral, nor heard a Christian service. And as Yoshio looked around, a strange realization struck him. Here was his chance, the chance he had prayed for over and over. Here was the chance to tell them all about Jesus Christ, the Lord of life. In a way, the prayer he had prayed for his son had come true. Little Kenji had brought these people together to hear God's word. Yoshio spoke out, telling them of Kenji's safe new home with the Lord. Here was a God who never disappointed his followers. And as they went to prayer, a quieting peace fell over Yoshio. Once again, God had shown himself to be Lord of every situation. It was the next day that Yoshio saw it happen. His mother was at her God shelf, performing her usual worship, when it almost looked as though she hesitated. Could she hesitate after nearly 50 years of ritual? I prayed and made offering, but my grandson died. Dear mother, please try to understand. Your prayers are to no one. And what of your Jesus? You prayed too, your son died. But I prayed for God's will to be done. I prayed for strength, for faith and understanding, that I might bear whatever God chose to happen. That prayer was answered, Mother. Jesus Christ is alive. You did not want your son alive? Of course I did. But I wanted God to have his way more. Kenji is happy now. He lives with the only living God, and I am satisfied with that. And so it was that, one by one, the offerings of ignorance, of fear, and of emptiness were taken from this Japanese family. The old life was closed. The new life in Jesus Christ had begun. The story of Yoshio is true. As a result of his son's funeral and his own victorious experience, meetings were begun in his home. Some who had marveled at what they had witnessed were among those who came. The meetings grew, and more of Yoshio's family came to Christ, including his once antagonistic brother. Today, in the city of Gobo, the Shinhama Baptist Church stands as a result of those meetings. We have told this story as the story of Yoshio because we know that Christianity is Christ living in the believer. At many places along the way, our missionaries have been used to preach, to counsel, to help. As you support them by your prayers and gifts, you too help. There are incalculable numbers in Japan who are empty, purposeless, and lost, as was Yoshio. There are many following ancient, empty religions, as was his mother. The same Jesus Christ offers the same fulfillment to them all. Working with our missionaries and nationals such as Yoshio, you and I can have a satisfying part in the bringing of the true living God to Japan.